Heyo guys, welcome to Voicy here. This is your host that totally did not almost shart, Captain Zach, and today's subreddit is r/IDon'tWorkYourLady with a bonus from r/todayIfudgedup.
Don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit that bell to never miss an episode.
This story's called, Not Everyone in a Suit Wants to Sell You a Car. Long-time lurker, first-time poster, in my line of work, I didn't think this could happen, but here we are. I'm a practicing attorney in an area known for a certain degree of schlongery being inherent to the local population. This incident occurred earlier today, and I just got the time to type this out. Just to set the stage, I wear a suit until I go to bed, and I'm just over 6 feet and 250 pounds. I own a heavily modified car, so I take it to the performance shop. I had to do the modifications every 2,000 miles or so for technical inspections and to dial in the tune. With the changing season and a few new components, we moved it to once every 500 miles to make sure everything's all proper, which means I'm having the car in for a lookover just about each week since I commute around 40 miles. Across the street from the shop is a dealership for very high-end cars. Specifically, one side serves a high-end British automaker known for ultra-luxury work, and an Italian brand known for being gaudy.
Bugatti?
I'm a bit of a gearhead, so I've taken to walking across the street to chat up the employees and to see if there's anything exciting enough for me to want to get a model car of for my desk in their inventory. I'm on good terms with the staff since a couple of them are former clients for rather exciting speeding tickets and the like, and my girlfriend is a sales representative at an Audi dealership in the same network. I'm examining a gorgeous green coupe and waiting for coffee an employee had gone to get since these dealerships have expensive coffee machines and damn it, they're gonna use them, especially for a friend. I feel a tap on my shoulder and turn around to only find what could be described as just under 5 feet of dark skin wrapped around silicone in the vague facsimile of a person looking at me with mild impatience, and attired in booty shorts and some sort of almost inadequate crop top in colors that can be described as a violent and sticky violation of one's eye sockets, and a pair of worryingly high heels. Just to be clear, in most cases, prospective customers make an appointment so that product specialists can devote their full attention to the needs of a client. At this moment, us and a local Instagrammer were the only people on the showroom floor. Can I help you? I ask. A mistake, to be sure, but one easy to make when you get through law school on customer service jobs. This entity proceeds to ask questions about the SUV offering of this brand, power, engines, what can fit in it, that sort of stuff. Being a gearhead, I actually know many of the things she asks, or can refer to a piece of laminated paper on a nearby example. Then she asked me for a test drive. Firstly, I don't work there, and secondly, I don't believe test drives happen for that level of car without one having already contracted to buy it. I attempt to answer with an, I'm sorry ma'am, but I cannot do that as I do not work here. This does not fly. She raises her voice and interrupts me before I can inform her of my lack of employment at the establishment.
It's because I'm black, isn't it?
Was what passed from the most definitely augmented lips. Firstly, no, and secondly, I don't work here. I try to be concise, already shifting into a mode of how I speak when speaking to the court.
Listen here, you deceitful, racist mother lover.
Her words, not mine.
I've seen you up in here talking with the salesmen's.
I remember that unneeded plural very clearly.
And I know you work with them, so let me test drive this
car brand.
And I'll forget about how rude you've been.
And she starts approaching very close at this point. Ma'am, I don't work here, and if I did, it would be hard to get a test drive any. I would be interrupted by one hand adorned in pink claws grabbing me by the necktie and dragging me down to her level. I remind you that I am 6 foot 1 and 250 pounds, and my head had been jerked down a good foot. My glasses fall to the floor.
Shut the heck up and get me those damn keys before I tell your manager.
It's at this point that my friend returns to the showroom with the coffee from the attached dealership and witnesses this goblin assailing his friend. He strides over, puts on a wide smile, and asks, "What's wrong?" She turns on her heel, resulting in a rather unpleasant crunch as said heels crushes the lens of my glasses. I didn't quite catch her rant directed at the real employee, but I did finally have enough of this. I pulled my card from my pocket, thrust it in her face, and spoke with the same voice I use in court to make conclusions. and the same little smile. "Ma'am, I do not work here. I am an attorney who is friends with several employees here. I just answered your questions because I love the products of brand, and I knew some things about it. Now, I'm going to ask you that either you hand over a check for $600 to cover damages you have inflicted upon my glasses, or I will get the police involved for the battery you performed upon my person." I then crossed my arms after a moment of looking between me and the door and the security cameras. She sighs and surprisingly pulls out a checkbook and writes me a check for the damages. I put it in my pocket and observe the general manager of the dealership, who had seen it happen on camera, rush out and ban her on the spot for assaulting somebody in his dealership before security, who'd been holding back until a manager gave word, escorted her out. The manager apologized profusely and gave me a fancy paperweight for free for my troubles. I thanked him and left after drinking the coffee. I got my prescription sunglasses from my car so I'd be able to safely drive, before calling up my boss, one of the partners at the firm, to tell him my side of events in case she tried something with the card I gave her. I took the check to her bank once the adjustments on my car were done, and surprisingly, it cashed out without incident. I'm going to the optometrist tomorrow to get new glasses, and according to my girlfriend, she actually got the notice at her dealership to deny service to that cretin as well. So, all's well that ends well. Well, that actually worked out pretty well. That Karen wasn't as bad as it could have been, or she. I mean, sure, he's gonna look kinda douchey walking around with sunglasses indoors, but hey, not too bad. Swift justice. This story's called Grumpy Construction Worker Yells at Me Cause He Be Power Trippin'. So I work a job as a service technician, and I went to a new building that needed some warranty work done. It had been officially handed over to the owners, which is a hotel. The contractors were still running about doing deficiencies and odds and ends, but the hotel staff was on-site training and such. I used to work for construction companies all the time, and I hated it because of the semantics of it all. They would be a stickler for rules inside the property at all times, but when it suited them, they would bend the rules. Hate that. Anyhow, this building had a door close to where I was working, and I propped it open to go to my truck, maybe 20 feet from the door itself. A 5-second walk. First contractor, head honcho on site, comes out and sees me on the phone out there and asks if I propped the door open. The thing is, there was another door propped open just on the other end of the hallway, but it led to a loading bay away from the street. It was okay to have that one open because there was a worker there. Semantics. I said, "Yeah, it's just loading tools right now, but I don't want to walk all the way around the building as I have a lot of tools to bring in." The guy was reasonable and he said, "Sure, son, not a problem. Just please remember to close the door. We don't want a hooligan coming and stealing the TV or something."
"Alright, no problem. I can do this for you." Told him I'm not just a laborer who have the reputation for not being the smartest of people, but I'm a decently smart technician in a complicated trade. He laughs and goes, "Alright, that makes me feel better. Plus he called me son, so that was nice."
He says, "Alright, as long as you're inside of that door and you aren't walking away, you can prop it open."
Cut to maybe 10 minutes later and I'm on the phone outside, no reception in the building, in clear view of the door, and his sidekick foreman guy is there. Young dude, small tiny guy, Eric Foreman, who tried hella hard to compensate. I could hear the way he was talking to employees. The dude's a schlong. I come inside as he's walking towards me and he goes,
"Hey, don't prop that door open, got it?"
I had time today. I didn't like being yelled at, so I simply said, "I'm right here. Don't worry, no one's going in. Spoke with your boss and he said it's cool." He stops, all bewildered and such, and responds,
"Do not open that door again!"
I ask him why he was yelling, and he goes,
"Hey, you listen to me when you're on this site, do you understand? I'm the boss, and I don't want you questioning me again!"
This is where I goofed. I wasn't wearing my company shirt, because it was hot in the room I was working in. It was a crawl space above the kitchen. Just had on a t-shirt. I simply look at the guy and said, "A, don't yell or speak to me like that again. B, I'm here on behest of the owners. I do not work for you guys in any shape or form. If you have a problem with me, go run to your boss or go to the owners and go tattle on me." He stopped and tried to say something, but you know when you've got someone dead to rights and they just kinda just try to say something? Exactly this. This guy didn't know what to do at all. He eventually just walked away and I chuckled to myself. That was a great feeling. Where you don't answer to someone when you don't represent the company to them. They can't say crap to you. You're working for the owners directly, and it's not going to reflect negatively on your company to say, hey, don't yell at me. I swear, some people's lives suck so much that this is how they feel in control of your lives. I want to have one of those moments someday. Usually when people ask me to do something, I usually just do it. Not because I'm scared of confrontation or something, but like, I don't really mind helping people out. I'm actually usually pretty eager to help. I'm not sure if it's because I like validation from others or because I like doing nice things for people. I don't know. I'm curious, have you guys ever been in a situation similar to this where you're working at the same place as some other company and the management there thinks that they're in charge of you, but they're not, and they were a jerk and you got to tell them to go shove it because that is not my job. This story's called, Today I by almost killing my grandma by giving her an edible. This was on Thanksgiving Day, not today, but just now deciding to share. My 36F female, husband, 36 male, travels for work, not at this moment, thanks, Brovid-19, and was in San Fran for a huge sales conference. While he was there, he decided to purchase some edibles. He took one while in San Fran and said they were great. Now, we're both very new to trying edibles as it just became medically legal in our state, and it always made me nervous to try them. But as I've gotten older, I've decided as long as I stay home and don't venture out, I'll be just fine. So a few days after he came home, we had some friends over and all of us enjoyed a nice gummy. These were way stronger than the only other one I had in Vegas, but we had a great time. Lots of laughs and lots of pies were had by all. Thanksgiving rolls around a week later, and I tell my grandma, 76 female, that the Hubs had gotten some amazing edibles and we should try them. Now, my grandma is not your ordinary grandma. She's kind of a hippie and probably one of the most awesome people on the planet, so this was not odd that Grammy would try one. But she's never had an edible before. I grab the gummies and inform my grandma that these are very powerful, and maybe she should only take half. My grandma looks me straight in the eyes and pops the entire damn thing in her mouth and says, "Eh, I'll be fine." I cringe a bit and think, okie dokie, here we go. We all grab a plate and make our dinner, and for about an hour goes by, and my grandma and grandpa walk over to get desserts, and I follow them. Grandma starts asking about the dessert, and mid-sentence, her words turn into complete gibberish, to which I started to laugh and said, "Are you feeling your edible, Grandma?" She then starts to act really weird, and my grandpa and I lock eyes and realize this may not be good. Right then, she straight up blacks out and collapses. My grandpa and I both catch her, and I start to slap the ever-living crap out of her and start yelling her name.
Yeah, I don't think you're supposed to do that.
I yell at my husband to come help and yell at my mom to call the ambulance. I finally get her to come too and make sure she stays awake and doesn't black out again. I don't know if that even mattered, but in my head, it was super important that she stay responsive. When the EMT finally show, they take her blood pressure and it was pretty much non-existent. They start talking about how she is probably having a stroke or something major, and all I can think is that I just killed my best friend. They load her up in the ambulance, and we tell my grandpa to get in and ride with her, but apparently my grandma didn't want anyone riding with her, so my grandpa starts to get into his own car to follow. I then told my grandma I didn't care what she wanted and that I was riding with her no matter what, and I proceed to climb in the front seat of the ambulance. Now, up until the point, I had not felt a gummy and thought I'll be good to ride. I couldn't have been more wrong. As I sit in the front with the ambulance driving, it hits me like a freaking freight train to the brain. As I'm realizing this, I start to get super nervous that he's gonna find out and I'm gonna go to jail, so my super logical brain says, "Act as professional as possible, that'll trick him." I'm so dumb. So he starts to ask me questions about the quickest way to get to the hospital from my house, and I literally changed my voice to try to sound like a damn Rhodes Scholar and use phrases like, "At the crest of the hill," and "Promptly after this tree," to give directions. I then start to ask him if he knows so-and-so at the fire department, and rattle off my super straight-laced friends who are firefighters or EMTs in our city. And yep, he knows all of them. I then proceed to laugh at a joke I made 10 minutes ago in a laugh that sounded like the cackle of a criminally insane person. After a 25-minute drive that felt like 3 hours, I very slowly and carefully climb out of the front of the ambulance and go check on Grammy in the back. Good news was, she was smart enough to tell them that she had had an edible and they gave her an IV, and were able to bring her blood pressure up back to normal by the time we got to the hospital. Once they checked her in, they looked her over and we were out in about 2 hours. When it was time to leave, I was coming back to Earth from my journey to Mars, but I was still feeling good, but definitely more normal. As I helped my grandma to her car, I asked her if my mom and grandpa were going to allow us to play together anymore, because we got ourselves in a lot of trouble. We both laughed our asses off later that day, but agreed not to do that again. Okay, first of all, if someone faints, do not try to slap them awake. Now, I'm no doctor or first aid specialist or whatever, but I know that that's not what you're supposed to do. I think I know, but I'm not gonna say it because I could be wrong and I don't want to give false medical information. I'm sure someone in the comments knows what you're supposed to do if someone faints. And it's not that. Anyways, that sounds like a pretty cool grandma. Smoke a gram with the gram.
Don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit that bell to never miss an episode.